If you've been writing SQL for a while, it's almost certain that at some point your boss or whoever has come to you and said, I've got this SQL query that needs some work. Can you help me out with it? And you're like, sure, no thing, I'll help you. And you pull up the query only to be confronted with something that is pages and pages and pages long. And you look at this and you just kind of put your head in your hands and cry a little bit inside and think to yourself, how on earth do I manage this? And it's when confronted with monstrosities like this that a lot of people think that SQL is just an unmaintainable nightmare. I'm here to show you it doesn't have to be like this. So, hi everyone, I'm Chris Saxon. I'm part of Gerald Venzel's developer advocate team. It's my job to help you get the best out of Oracle Database and hopefully have a little bit of fun whilst doing so. So, let's get started. Now, imagine you've been called in to help write a report. Your boss or whoever has asked, they want to know the total and average salaries for departments with more than three staff grouped by region. So let's just jump in and start writing that query. So first up, we need to count the number of people in each department. We can do that like this. And then we need to filter out these small departments. So one way is to use an inline view like this. So we're restricting it to those with more than three. And this is okay for a small query like this, but we're going to need to do more here. We're going to make it a bit larger. So rather than using inline views, what I'm going to do is refactor this into a named subquery using the with clause, common table expressions, subquery factoring. It has many names. So we'll give this query a name, and then we can use it in the where clause. So this is the same as the previous statement, but I think it will make things a little bit easier to manage as we go on. So having done this filtering, we then need to join from the departments through locations and countries up to the region. So that is a series of joins, which looks a bit like this. So what I'm going to do is put this in another named subquery. So we'll add that to our statement. We can see we've got it there. And then we will join them together and do the filtering. So that has got the information we're looking for. So this is looking pretty good. It's not too complicated, but thinking about it, this set of joins here, that's probably a common set of joins we'd like to use throughout our application. And as great as the with clause is, one of the drawbacks is I can reuse this query within the statement, but I can't reuse it in different queries. So to help simplify this query and make this whole component reusable, what I'll do is create it into a view. Just put all those joins in a view and just check those work. There we go. We've got that information there. And then we can replace that whole CTE, that with clause, with that view. So this helps simplify our query quite a bit. And we can now reuse these joins elsewhere in our application. So we've got most of the information. Finally, we need to group it up by region and get the total and averages. Notice I put the filtering in its own CTE again, and there's our overall information. So this is pretty good. And as I said, it's not too big a SQL statement, but really I'd like that query in the report to be nice and super simple, just select star from table. And part of me is thinking at the back of my head, I'd like to be able to reuse this elsewhere in the application too. So what we'll try and do, we'll do both these things by making it into a view. So we'll create another view that holds that information. And now the query in the report is nice and simple, and we can put it in other places in the app. So on this point, you're kind of like, we're done with that. You show it back to your boss, and they kind of look at it and go, nice work, well done. But can you rerun that report? But this time, instead of departments with more than three people, I want you to filter it to departments with more than 10 people. And you're like, sure, no thing, I'll help you out with that. But at the back of your mind, you're kind of going, hang on, that view we just created isn't going to work. We've hard-coded the value 3 into the view, and we cannot parameterize it. We're kind of a bit stuck here. And this was always a bit of a classic dilemma with SQL. We'd like simple, reusable things, but we cannot parameterize views. And then you're like, oh, what do? I'm a bit stuck here. Fortunately, there is a way out of this problem, SQL macros. So these are a new, relatively new feature to help you define reusable SQL expressions. And those expressions can be one of two types, table or scalar. So table macros, as you might guess from the name, replace a real physical table, view, name, subquery in your statement, and they go in the from clause. So they are returning a query. Scalar macros, on the other hand, are returning classic data types, numbers, dates, strings, and so on. And you'd use these pretty much anywhere else you could use in your SQL statement. So pretty much anywhere you could use a PLSQL function. So the select clause, where clause, order by, and so on and so forth. Another slight thing to be aware of, this SQL macros were originally slated to be 21c feature only. Table macros have been backported to 19c. So 19c is our current long-term support release, the version we expect most of you to spend most of your time on for the next few years. So partly for that reason, but also because I think they're much cooler, there's more interesting things you can do with them, I'm going to be focusing on table macros for this session. So that's the overview. How do we actually create a macro? Well, it's a bit like creating a PLSQL function. All we need to do is add this new clause, SQL macro, and state whether or not it's table or scalar. If you omit it, by default, they are table macros. Now you'll notice I'm returning a clob here. You're like, well, what's with that? Well, SQL macros always return text. And that is the text of the expression, and the database resolves that and makes it part of your SQL statement. So that's kind of like the theory. Let's make one for real. Let's try and do that filtering of the employees by department count and make that a macro, because we want to parameterize that, change what the threshold is. So we've got our query here. I've gone back to an inline view just for space reasons, so it fits in the slide a bit better, really. But we want to pass in how many employees we're filtering on. So we will quote this whole thing, turn it into a function, and have a parameter for what that threshold is. Notice that parameter appears in the string. So then how does this work? Well, when you call this macro at parse time, essentially what the database does is a find and replace of those parameter placeholders in this string. And this is a textual find and replace. So if you pass in the value 3, then that number, that literal, becomes part of the string. However, if you pass in a bind variable instead, the database doesn't peek at it or evaluate it in any way. The bind variable itself becomes part of the SQL statement. So that's kind of the overview on how they work. Let's jump back to a demo and show how it works in practice. So first up, just to kind of prove that we can't actually parameterize views, I'm trying to pass in min employees here. If I create this, we're going to find it doesn't work and I am going to get an error. So we've got a problem. It's invalid syntax. So let's take this CTE and the filtering for it and make that into a SQL macro. So put that all, notice it's all quoted, it's all strings, and I've got my parameter to do the filtering on it. So let's create that. And then we can call it. We can filter it by different values. So we're getting employees, departments with 3 or more employees in them. We can increase that, change it so it's more than 30, and so on. So we've got our nice reusable query now. And we can then use this just like a regular table. So we can replace those name subqueries in our previous statement. So we can join to that instead. So now this is basically the same as what we had earlier, but we've parameterized it. So I can pass in and search for, you know, departments with more, 3 or more people in them. I can change that to departments with more than 10 people, and we'll see the result changes a little bit. So we've got our reusable thing and our nice simple statement. So this is already pretty cool, but actually we can do even more cool things with SQL macros. So if we think about what's going on inside here, we are counting the values for a particular column and then filtering on that. And actually, this kind of query pattern is something we might want to apply to different tables or different columns in the same table. For example, instead of filtering by department, we might want to show all the employees where there's 10 or more people who do the same job as them or something like this. The really cool thing about macros is we can make these columns and table names parameterizable too. So let's see how. So what first thing is, we need to add those parameters. Got the table and our group column. So these use these DBMSTF parameters. Table T is a table identifier, just the name of one table. Columns T, on the other hand, uses the column pseudo operator to accept an array, comma separated list of column identifiers. And we've got our threshold we're searching for. So notice we've got source table in the string. The database will replace that with the actual table name. But because the columns is an array, there's no implicit way in SQL to turn an array into a string. So we've had to concatenate in the element that we're looking for. So let's create that macro. There, we've got it. And now we can call it. So this is now doing the same thing as our previous macro, employees filtered by department size, because we're passing in the employee and the department ID. But the really neat thing is we can pass in different columns and tables. As I said, we might want to filter employees to have where there's more, 10 or more people doing the same job. So instead of department, we can pass in the job ID like this. And there we go, we've got it filtered by job as well. Really, really cool. And as I said, we can change the table too as well. So we've now got locations and we're counting by country. So if we run this and we'll say all the locations where there's three or more locations in that country as well. You can see we've got that information. So this is really cool. We can now pass in table names and column names at when we're calling this to make our query template. So let's use this instead. Let's swap that out into our macro and show we can use it same as we did before. So at this point, this is pretty cool now. We can, we've got our fully parameterizable query where we can search for different numbers of employees in each department, change the things as well if we want. But to be honest, I'd like to go back to that nice simple select star from query we had when we were using the view, but this time with the parameter. Now, great thing about macros is macros can call macros. So we can put this whole thing inside a SQL macro. So we can just copy paste that there, making sure we are having a parameter for what our employee threshold is like that. We'll create that. And now we can call this and you'll see I'll pass it with different values and we'll get a slightly different result each time. So we're getting different values. And notice finally, there's no departments in Europe with 40 or more people in them. So we recap what we've done. We've used CTEs to kind of build up our query and make it more manageable. And then we've broken them down. We've created our view to make those joins reusable and created our macros to make those parameterizable queries for us. Very, very nice. But in the process of doing this, there's a couple of questions that might arise. First up is, in doing all this refactoring, have I actually got it right? Have I made a mistake in the process? Does it do the same thing? Interesting question. And then the other important question is, okay, our final SQL statements here, nice and simple, but what if we need to debug or change them for some reason? How do we know what's actually going on under the covers? How can we figure out that out? Well, let's start with this first question. Nice thing about SQL is it's really easy to do kind of table comparison with set differences. So this query will compare the old and new query approaches we had, the view and using the macro. And if I've got it right, this query will return no rows. So let's just kind of fingers crossed. Hopefully this will come back with no information. We'll run it and I made a mistake somewhere in the process. So there's an error. Need to figure out what's going on here. So that leads us to that next question I had. How can we see the full underlying statement and know what's really going on under the covers? Well, there's this DBMS utility expand SQL text. It's been around since about 12c. We can pass it our macro and it will get us the full underlying SQL statement. So let me just pull that up, bring it up. And if we just format it so we can see what's going on a bit better, we can see here's our statement, there's our totals. If we keep going, there's our count grouped by department. And if we go a bit further, there we are filtering that count where it's greater than or equal to the bind variable value we are passing in. Hang on a second. Greater than or equal to, that's not right, is it? We were originally asking where we were strictly greater than, weren't we? Okay, I've made like a copy paste error somewhere in this process. I made it greater than or equal to when it should have been strictly greater than. So let's just change the macro where we're doing our filtering and check that that's solved the problem. Let's do our set difference. Now, hopefully, okay, fingers crossed. Hopefully this has fixed it and we will get no rows from this. And there we go. The queries are identical. So we were really easily able to check after the refactoring, does in fact return the same information. Very nice, really powerful things of SQL. So at this point, let's just kind of recap what we did here. We started off with our queries, building it up. And we saw we could use views to refactor those common joins. These are the original and classic way to make reusable queries. They work great for basic joins and where clauses, but as we saw, if you've got counts, sums, other types of aggregation, you cannot parameterize them, limiting their reuse. We used CTEs, the with clause, to build up our query. This makes it easier to kind of build up and maintain, you know, break it down into logical units and build it up as we go along. The big drawback of these is while you can reuse those CTEs within the statement, you can't reuse them in different queries, right? They are local to that statement. So if we've got reusable logic, we have to go through a different approach. So, you know, both of these gives us bits of the solution, but not the full thing. So finally, we saw with SQL macros, we could do both of these things. We could have our reusable expressions that are fully parameterizable. And the really, really cool thing is not only can you pass like standard data types, numbers, dates, strings to SQL macros, you can actually use them to create query templates that you can pass tables and columns to. There's some further links for more reading if you're interested. So all that's left for me to say is, really hope you enjoyed this. More importantly, I hope you learned something. I'm Chris Saxon. See you next time.